you. Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to stand here before you tonight. As a man who wrote much on revolutions and rights and reason, and was also more than once misunderstood much, even up until today. Now, I am also a man who spent the first 37 years of my life remarkably unremarkable in England. Then I was lucky enough to meet Benjamin Franklin, the esteemed Benjamin Franklin, who suggested that I sail to that place of new hope and last resort, the colonies. When I arrived, as I set my foot into this country, a fire was lighting all around my ears, the assaults at Concord and Lexington. And it was time to stir. It was time for men to stir. Even as the Continental Congress continued to talk about reconciliation with the crown. So I wrote Common Sense. Simple facts, plain sentences, common sense, and in short sentences, to encourage the colonists, to every man, farmer, tailor, soldier, craftsman, artisan, to convince them that America could and should fight and win a war against the tyranny of His Majesty, King George III, and to create a new government, a republic of and by and for the people. Well, my pamphlet went down very well, except with the Tories, the Loyalists, the Royalists, the landed gentry of America who benefited much from their oath to the crown, they were not quite as appreciative. And John Adams, he hated common sense because it was so democratical. He said it was a poor, short-sighted, malicious, confused, crapulous mass. I compared him to a number of animals and better yet, vegetables. And I did say that we have it in our power to begin the world over again. So, tonight I am very happy to have been invited by the Thomas Paine Society to discuss the most important issue, the issue of government, the issue of the role, the size, even the necessity of government. Now, I must say, I was astounded to learn that 236 years after the revolution, this is still a matter of debate. And then I came across a book which explains some of the confusion. Glenn Beck's Common Sense. The Case Against an Out-of-Control Government, inspired by Thomas Paine. Is the term crapulous mass still in use today? Now, I did say in my common sense that society in every state is a blessing. But government, even in its best state, is but a necessary evil, and in its worst state, an intolerable one. Now, I stand by that today, but it has led to much misunderstanding. So I would like to explain. Imagine a group of people who settle in some far away place, far away from any civilization. Now, four or five of them together could build a house. One person on their own could not accomplish anything. As a group, they could build a city. As individuals, they would all perish. So necessity will force them to form themselves into a society. Now, as long as they support and care for each other, they have no need of government. But as time passes, and as people become less supportive and less attached to each other. The time will come when they must form some kind of government to balance the loss of morality and virtue. Morality and virtue. You see, government is the badge of lost innocence and a necessary evil. Now, at first, a tree would suffice as a state house for these people. They would assemble under the branches and deliberate on public matters. But as the colony expanded, the people would need to choose a few to deliberate on their behalf, always with the same concerns and the same way of acting as the people. And now this is most important. The elected must never be allowed to form their own special interests, different to the interests of the people. And to ensure this, there must be elections often, and the elected must go and meet with and speak with the people, the electors, to ensure that they understand the concerns of the people and are committed to taking care of them. Then you have mutual trust and respect. Only this will lead to strong government and a happy governed. Now, there were those in the America of my time, and I believe perhaps in the America of your time, who were beginning to contemplate government as a profitable monopoly, to take money to the rich from the cost of the rest of us. See, John Adams, he said that America, the United States, should be governed by a few of the most wise and best, the rich and well-born and able. Alexander Hamilton said that the rich and well-born should have a distinct permanent place in government to check the imprudence of democracy. A republic must be a republic not just in principles, but in reality. Then, as to the question of the role of government in our lives, I had come to realize the importance of shared, communal, social responsibility to be as equally important as individual concerns. The widowed, the elderly, newly married couples, the unemployed, veterans, children who would be required to attend school must be provided for from state funds. And these funds will be provided through taxation. And they will be given not as a charity, but as a right. And as to land, we all inherit the earth, so that when land is improved through cultivation, it is the improvement alone and not the earth itself that is individual wealth. So that custodians of land must pay the community a tax for the land which they hold. And that tax will finance a national fund to pay everyone at age 21 a sum in compensation, part compensation for their lost inheritance of land, and a sum every year to every person aged 50, and to those blind and disabled who cannot provide for themselves for the rest of their lives. And this will not be a charity, but a right. Not endowments or entitlements, but justice. Always justice. Any country that can say, my poor are happy, and there is neither ignorance nor suffering to be found among them. My jails are empty of prisoners, my streets of the homeless, The elderly are taken care of. The taxes are not oppressive. The rational world is my friend. That country has a right to boast its constitution and its government. The greatest good that we can achieve is to ensure that all people have the support and the comforts that they deserve, that are their rights. It is not a question of big government or small government. It is a question of rights and of justice. So, ladies and gentlemen, I will take my leave of you in the hope that you will understand that you truly do have it in your power to begin the world over again, and that then the role of society will blossom as we all support each other. And then the role of government can shrink as we restrain our vices and our greed. And then perhaps, when the legislators meet under the branches of the tree, they will act in the same way as we, the people, would act if only the tree was large enough to encompass us all. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you and good night.